Hi, I'm Sheila Kuehl. Welcome to Get Used to It, our show where we discuss issues of interest about gay and lesbian people. Today we have a show I hope will be of interest to everybody. It's about education. Everybody's talking about education. And there's been a lot of discussion lately about the impact of discrimination and harassment in our schools, what the fallout is, what the problems are, whether it's any big deal. And here in California, we have recently passed a law indicating that discrimination and harassment on the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity in the schools is not allowed. And we are in the throes, I think, of trying to design an implementation for the law, and that's what we're going to talk about today, but in the broader context, I think, of education. I have three great guests, Christopher Calhoun, who is the Media Relations Manager at the Southern California ACLU. Welcome, Christopher.
Thanks.
Valerie Johnson, who's a high school teacher in Orange County here in California. Welcome, Valerie.
Thank you.
And Diane Valdez, who is the project coordinator for Make It Real, a project we'll be talking about in a couple of minutes, and also a student at UCLA. Welcome, Diane.
Thank you.
Christopher, let's start with you.
Okay.
Sort of in the big picture notion, why is it that we're even interested in issues of discrimination and harassment in the schools particularly?
Well, I think it's because schools are one of the places where people are educated about who they are. And people learn to think about themselves and to think about their relationship to society. And well, let me just tell a little bit of a story. When I was growing up in Oregon, in a small town, I had a very loving family, but a fundamentalist Christian family, so obviously not supportive of gay and lesbian issues. But for my first 6 years, I never once heard any kind of thing about, you know, any anti-gay sentiment whatsoever. I heard that when I was 6 years old, when I started school. And I think that is sort of one of the two, those are the two big places where we learn about ourselves. So, in order to make education an experience where it's not damaging to students, it doesn't prevent them from learning, and they can grow to their full potential, we have to make sure that it's safe, that it supports each person's individuality and creativity and uniqueness, and that it's something that supports every single person. So that's why we need to have schools that really draw some lines about behavior.
Well, you know, it's not a new experience either for our community. I mean, every minority kind of experienced these issues, and it seems to be focused often around issues, as you said, at school and in the family, the two places where we kind of develop our notion of right and wrong, of self and other, etc. I remember that Norman Rockwell magazine cover, mm-hmm. of the little girl surrounded by, you know, the huge sort of police who were escorting her into a little African-American girl into a school, and how bewildered the children were at all the hatred that was shown to them. But it certainly did give them the understanding, which is what it was supposed to, that they were something less, that they were something wrong or bad, that they were not wanted there by adults and, you know, by the other children. So we've got these situations in the schools, and it seems like gay and lesbian kids are pretty much the current target of this harassment and discrimination, and often straight kids that aren't gay or lesbian, but somebody thinks they are, or they're acting that way, or not acting right for their gender, or whatever. What do you think the best way for schools, for districts, for states to handle this?
Well, it's all of the different entities you mentioned have to take some action to handle this, starting from students, parents, teachers, administrators, administrators at the school site, administrators at the district site. Legislators need to also respond to this problem. And fortunately, California, they have. After a lot of struggle, after years of organizing on the part of students, on the part of activists around the state, after some real leadership, we have a bill. We have a law in California that says this kind of discrimination is not allowed, and that is what we start with. We can use that as a tool. Students can use that as a tool. teachers and administrators can use that as a tool to say, hey, look at this environment. What are our parameters? What's allowed? What's not allowed? This is how we're going to do it. An interesting story I want to tell you about one student that I know. She worked very actively in support of AB 537. She came to lobby 2 years in a row on the bill up in Sacramento, along with hundreds of other students around the state. There were 700 at the most recent lobby day, the one that sort of finally pushed things over the edge. She, as soon as the bill was passed, she printed up a copy from her computer, put it in her backpack, and carried it. She actually copied a stack of them. And she carried it around with her everywhere at school. She carried it around when she met other students who were gay or lesbian. And she used it as a tool for her own empowerment, something to say, this is wrong, when she encountered prejudice, harassment, discrimination of any sort. So even on that sort of tiny level, not tiny, because it's not tiny at all, but even on that sort of individual level, a bill or a law can be tremendously empowering. Now, what are the other kinds of things that have to happen? There's a lot that needs to happen to make it something that institutions take seriously, something that the whole state understands, something that students just, as a matter of course, accept as their condition for being part of school and how they act in a school community. But that one inspiring example of a student with a stack of bills, sack of the law in her backpack is something that really inspires me. So.
Students were very deeply involved in lobbying for my bill, and I, you know, it was really interesting and inspiring because they were scared to death. I mean, a number of them, of course, you know, came up not just from counties where they might have gotten some support or families where they might have gotten some support, but counties where it was very difficult for them to be out in school and. But they came up for Queer Youth Lobby Day. Mm-hmm. And it was certainly a statement even to call it Queer Youth mm-hmm. Lobby Day, and that's what it was called, and that's what the press knew it was called, but they needed to set an example for their peers as well of really saying get used to it, and went to talk to their legislators. And it was interesting to me, because as you know, I brought the bill three mm-hmm. different sessions in a row before we finally got it, to see the growth in the students themselves, not just the numbers, but their own kind of understanding that they didn't have to simply come up there and go, I don't care what you think as a legislator, I'm going to tell you about my life, to not apologizing for it, but understanding that there were a lot of people that just had no idea what their life was like at all, and actually didn't want there to be harassment in the schools necessarily. Because there's a sort of sentimentality about education mm-hmm. and that there should be just education going on. You know, why aren't they learning to read? Why aren't they learning math? And to help people understand that this is static, you know. Do you find that straight students were also supportive?
Oh, yeah. Many of the students who participated in Youth Lobby Day were straight. And they just believe in the cause. They have friends. They see clear parallels to other civil rights movements, and they wanted to be on the right side. And they came up and spoke out really clearly in support of this bill, and that was really good. Sometimes a person who is not as intensely affected has the freedom to carry the message, and straight students really did that. They do that every day on campuses in California and throughout the nation and as part of gay straight alliances. They've really been great partners for their LGBT peers and their questioning peers. And many of them sometimes are targeted themselves because they're perceived to be, because of their activity, gay or lesbian. But yeah, they definitely did play a big part.
It's interesting, isn't it, how the schools become kind of a battleground about culture or everything. I mean, rights. A lot of people criticize us because we're allegedly putting all of this burden on the schools and on the teachers, and of course I'll talk to Valerie about this in a minute, that all of this social justice stuff, you know, has to go on in the schools. But it wasn't so much that we felt it needed to be taught as that it needed to be untaught.
Right.
That
exactly.
There needed to be some attitude.
And it's such a, to describe it as this burden that's being put on, that's exactly how they thought of it. But it was a burden being lifted off of students, and we're trying to lift and help students lift that burden off themselves. Yeah, that's how I see it.
What do you think, Valerie?
Well, I've been When I was a young person, I experienced harassment myself in school, in the classroom of a teacher who said nothing at all about it. And ever since I've been a teacher, I've been trying to be, ever since the time that I felt secure in my job situation, to be as out as possible so that students could come and talk to me. What Christopher said about unburdening the schools, there is a kind of a culture of ignorance that takes hold in high schools that, unfortunately, for too long, teachers and administrators have kind of felt like, well, this is so overwhelming and so pervasive, there's nothing we can do about it, it's just kids being kids. You, for example, have students who use faggot as the epithet of choice. It doesn't matter whether the student they're talking to happens to be gay and lesbian, gay or not. And not even, I mean, it certainly is addressed to anyone who has a non-traditional interest in a sport or career path or art form, who dresses or walks or talks differently than the norm. But it's also just used as a general epithet, and it's that kind of harassment has actually played a part in some of the school shootings. Mm-hmm. The Columbine High School, the most recent one in Santana High School, these students, although they weren't even gay, had been victimized by being called fag. Beyond that, it has been part of teen slang for at least 20 years for students to take anything they don't like, whether it's a teacher's assignment or someone's shoes that they think are ugly, and say, oh, that's so gay. And for too long, people in the schools had kind of thought, oh, that's just teen slang, they don't mean anything by it, and they'd let it go in one ear and out the other. I think that the law has made a tremendous, tremendous difference, because what it does is, it not only protects those students who are gay or lesbian or who are questioning, and many, many of those students, you know, I won't know who they are until maybe they come back and visit me long after graduation. Many, many kids, they are thinking this and they're questioning, but they're too afraid to mention it to anyone else. So when someone makes a joke or a slur in class, or they just say, oh, that, you know, that stupid assignment was just so gay, that's never victimless, because there's someone there who's listening and who that's affecting. So the law makes a tremendous difference, because it not only protects those students, it protects teachers and administrators who want to do the right thing and stop that climate of harassment. When they can say, you know, I think teachers had been afraid in many cases to intervene, because they feared, you know, having a big discussion in class, having the principal get a call from some hostile parent. When that law now is in place, you know, it protects the teachers and administrators who want to do the right thing. And I think that makes a huge, huge difference. I personally think that it's the most significant development in bringing social justice to our schools, probably since Title IX or Brown v. Board of Education.
So. What can teachers do, though? What do you do?
Well, what I do is, I did something very similar to what Christopher talked about with the young lady. Before I left my classroom in December 1999 for Christmas vacation, I printed up on my computer the full text of the pertinent paragraph of that new legislation, and I made signs for my classroom. When the students came back in January, I said, this is the law now. It applies to actual or perceived, so this means, you know, it doesn't matter if someone gets called a dumb Mexican, whether that person happens to be from El Salvador or not, it's still wrong. And it doesn't matter whether, you know, someone actually is gay or lesbian, you cannot say you freaking homo to them. And it's just simply not acceptable. And then once they know that that's how I feel about it, there are still some slip-ups, but I listen for what I hear. And I try, when I do hear something, because it's not perfect, it still continues to happen sometimes, I try to use that as a teachable moment. I haven't seen it as something for which students would necessarily be disciplined for, unless it's repeated and directed at a particular victim. Most of the time, as I say, it's general conversation that's happening. And so I try to use that as a teachable moment and just say, you know, we don't know who is gay or lesbian, who might, you know, maybe someone in this classroom, their mom is now in a relationship with a woman partner, or maybe there's someone here, you know, whose brother came home from college last weekend and told the family that he's gay. We can't tell, so you could be hurting the feelings even of a good friend. And I think that by approaching the students in my class, taking the point of view that they are young adults and that they want to do the right thing and that they don't intentionally want to be hurtful to someone, I think most of the time they respond to this better than they do to a punitive approach. But that's what I do, and that's what I've tried to encourage other teachers to do, and I've heard of more and more of them doing it.
Well, it's interesting to me when Christopher said it was like removing a burden, because I think that it's an interesting thing about students. My experience is that students really care about fairness.
Mm-hmm, they
I mean,
do.
They often feel they're not treated fairly, and that's where it starts, kind of like fairness is about how I feel I'm treated. But it becomes a teachable moment because they generally think, well, things ought to be fair.
Mm-hmm, they do.
And if they're participating in unfairness, then they ought to know, they have to at least choose to do it. It's the wrong thing to do, and if they're choosing to do it, it's the wrong thing, and it has some fallout. And it was interesting to me, too. I don't want to blame all the school shootings on sort of this name-calling kind of thing, because they're obviously, there's a lot going on in young people who finally decide to get a gun and go shoot people. Mm-hmm. And a lot of our students obviously don't. Mm-hmm. But it still has this cumulative effect of the harshness of the environment. But what about among the teachers themselves? Does this make a difference in the teaching staff?
I think it does. I was very fortunate in having a principal who's supportive and who, as soon as this had become the law, allowed me about a 30-minute window at a staff meeting to talk to our staff about the law and about gay and lesbian kids. And many of them, you know, they said they had never considered some of these things before. They had never considered, for instance, like that middle school students are going through this too, because at the same age that kids in middle school who are heterosexual start to get crushes on opposite sex peers, the same is happening for kids who are starting to realize they're gay and lesbian. Happened to me in the 7th grade. And so they were very interested in this. And I happen to, where I teach, the majority of our staff, I would say, is quite conservative. We have a lot of people who are involved in the local religious community, a lot of people who are politically very conservative. I have to tell you, when I went up there, my heart was pounding. I don't have much stage fright today compared to that day. But people actually applauded when I finished, and I've kept hearing stories from students like the auto shop teacher who sat all these boys down in his class and said, okay, better not be saying fag in here. Or the teacher who has all the National Rifle Association stickers all over her SUV, who, you know, she wanted lots of my posters and things to put around the class and to educate her special ed students about it, and also to tell them how this protects them too. Just as often as I say, you know, you cannot be saying that's so gay in my class, I have to stop kids from saying, oh, you're such a retard. Mm-hmm. And I basically use a lot of the same logic and reasoning as a teachable moment with them. And I just was kind of floored by the response, and I have seen it make a difference. I have really seen it make a difference. So I feel it, you know, it's probably the most worthwhile thing that's happened.
Well, you know, the state superintendent of education here in California pulled together, as she was required to actually, a task force to design some recommendations to schools on how to comply with the law. Because the law, I mean, you've seen the law.
Yes.
It's not a lot of words.
No.
And the question is, well, you know, what does that mean? How do I handle this situation or that situation? What do I do? And the recommendations are made primarily to districts, but I think primarily to principals. And there's a lot of training recommendations in there. With all the stuff that teachers have to do, does training really help them on this stuff?
Oh, yes. I think it's absolutely essential. And I think, despite the fact that, from what I understand, the task force has put out a quite lengthy document, I think that because teachers do have a lot on their plate with all this standardized testing, accountability, and other things, I think that a 30 to 60 minute staff training is probably optimal, and I think it's really, really important that it be required, because I've done some workshops that are voluntary, and you know, the people that are there are very interested, but it's a small group. When I was able to go to some of the schools in our district and talk to a staff meeting where attendance was mandatory, I think that made a difference. And it was very brief. I basically just explained about the law and about the no slur policy, and also about how despite what one's personal religious views might be, we still have a duty as educators to, you know, affirm the worth of every student and to make a school a welcoming climate for them. And And just as a teacher who was a, you know, very devout Christian would still not be able to make any anti-Semitic remarks or allow other students to do so in their class, it really works the very same way with this. And I think when you present it to people that way, that they're much more receptive to it.
What do you think, Diane? You've been, well, as a high school student even, you were active in this issue, and now you're actually project director for a project that's involved kind of an implementation. Tell us about the Make It Real project.
Basically, what our focus is on students, and we go into high schools and train students and try to give them the tools to actually implement AB 537 and empower them to use the law to change their school climate. And so I think that's really exciting. And we've produced a manual that teaches a lot of activism strategies, some that are specifically related to AB 537 and some that are just related to general activism strategies. And we've seen I think it really empowers students a lot. I think they're really excited about it. I've seen students who just are really upset and angry and feel like they don't really have a voice, but then when we give them the tool and we give them the law and teach them how to be activists, it really empowers them, and it makes them feel like they can really make a difference in their schools, and they can.
So. How did you get involved?
How did I get involved?
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's a difference between feeling like something's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Every student in the United States feels like something's wrong in their school. But not every one of them does something about it. Or, I mean, even when you are given a tool sometimes, you know, how is an activist born?
Let's see, I went to a private Catholic all-girls high school, and it was kind of a conservative environment, and I just decided that I really wanted to make a difference. I came from a very liberal family. My parents are very supportive of me, and I was lucky enough to have friends who are really supportive of me, and I challenged the school, and I got a lot of student support, and
challenged them in by coming out?
Yes, first of all by coming out and being an openly gay student in my high school, and by challenging a rule that they had about not allowing people to take a member of the same sex to the prom. And so
How did you challenge that?
I passed a petition around, and I got 85% of the student body to sign it, and It was really an empowering experience. I got to, by being openly gay, I got to educate a lot of other students about it who were just completely unaware of the issues, and I got a lot of support, and it was really a great experience for me. And even though the rule didn't change, I learned a lot from it, and I think it really profoundly shaped who I am today, and I started working on this project, and I really want to encourage students to do the same thing, and I think it's a great experience.
But you're a student now as well,
mm-hmm.
at UCLA. Is it a different environment in the colleges?
Yeah, I think it's generally more accepting. I think people don't really stand for slurs in general on college campuses, especially something as big as UCLA. My high school is really small, so it was a little bit more difficult. But I think UCLA is very accepting, and I think in universities people are pretty open-minded and they're pretty liberal and they support LGBT issues a lot.
So what is the Make It Real project? Does it go into schools? Are there a lot of people involved?
We have a group of trainers, and we send people out into schools with our manual that basically has a lot of information about AB 537 and complaint procedures and how students file complaints within their districts about harassment and discrimination.
Do you go at the invitation of the school?
We try to do outreach, and we contact Project 10 groups and Gay Straight Alliances in schools and try to set up meetings with them and go in and train the students. But we have been contacted, and people invite us to their schools to talk about these issues. And we focus mainly on encouraging students to file complaints, because I think a lot of schools are just unaware of the fact that harassment and discrimination go on at all. And so by having students really come forward and say, this is what I experience every day, this is what I have to deal with, then schools really have to confront these issues, and they're really held accountable by the students. And we also focus on giving them general activism strategies and try to teach them how to organize, how to educate people, how to pressure their schools to create faculty trainings and teacher training programs, how to go to their school boards and lobby for a compliance plan with AB 537, and all sorts of strategies. It's really exciting.
There must be a lot of schools that wouldn't let you anywhere near them, though.
Actually, we haven't really encountered that too much. It's been pretty good. It's a little bit difficult to do a lot of outreach because some schools have requirements about who can come speak at their schools. But in general, we've been able to reach a lot of students, and it's really good.
What's the best thing that you've seen happen among students that you worked with?
Oh, there's been a lot of exciting things. One student after the training program went to her district and started asking questions and saw if anybody knew about AB 537, and nobody did. And so she wrote back to me and said that nobody knew what AB 537 was. They didn't know that they are responsible for having a person to receive complaints about harassment and discrimination. And so she basically pressured them to do that. And by doing so, it was established in that district that there is a person to receive complaints, and this is a law, and they are accountable for it. In Contra Costa County, there's a queer youth action team, and using some of the materials that we produced, the manual, and also working with the Gay Straight Alliance Network, they pressured their school board to create a compliance plan with AB 537 long before the task force released their recommendations. And that was very student-led. It's very exciting. So students are really taking this into their hands and making a difference.
Do you think change can happen at the school if you don't work with the students?
I think it's a combination of things. I think it's good to do to work with faculty and administrators, but I think on a day-to-day level, in terms of the school climate, it really is up to the students to be educated and to be active and make themselves visible and really take matters into their own hands and tell people that it's not okay. I mean, if students hear, "Oh, that's so gay," or another slur, it's, you know, they need to say, "Oh, that's not cool, you can't say that." And I think that that is really effective, and I think that's a great way to make change.
You know, it was like I was talking to Christopher about Queer Youth Lobby Day, and one of the interesting things that I used to work with students at UCLA, actually, in the administration during the old student revolution in the 60s, and it was really interesting to me what would happen to students that got involved. Mm-hmm. Because first of all, you have to watch out. It ends up, I mean, you could end up like me, where you'll never make a lot of money in your life because you're too busy thinking, there's just one more thing I've got to try and change here, you know. But it's just, I don't know, it kind of sets a whole different meaning in your life, don't you think? Did this happen to you as a student, Christopher?
You know, not as a student. I didn't start my activism until several years ago as an adult. But it had that transformative effect on me, even as an adult, where you really achieve a different kind of relationship to what your experience was, and you think about it anew. So yeah, I mean, one of the things that I felt sort of a lot of adult activists kind of work out different issues sometimes by taking on things that they didn't really get a chance to work through when they were younger. Mm-hmm. So in terms of the gay and lesbian youth issue and discrimination and harassment, it was a really intensely emotional experience and an intensely involving experience because of that, those layers of things that had been packed down for so many years. And it really, really strengthened me, I think. And I see the same thing in students. I see them turn from people who are pulled back and easily victimized and think of themselves as victims but don't think of themselves as actors, become something different, become outspoken activists, people who stand up for their own rights and for other people's rights, people who are able to criticize what's unjust and wrong. And that is really what it means, I think, to be a citizen in a democracy, and that's what we're involving students in. So
the hard thing for some of the students was telling the bad stories. I mean, it was interesting to me, Diane, that your experience that you found empowering at your high school ended in failure from the point of view of kind of, well, did you get them to change the policy? And the answer is, well, no. Mm-hmm. But it was an empowering experience. And it's very important, I think, for people, not just students, but everybody, to understand that sometimes you're not going to win, but the fight is really an important thing. I mean, I know you've been involved with GLSEN.
Yes, I have. And also, I wanted to say, because when Chris was mentioning about his activism, I came out, finished my teacher education, and became an activist all at one time when I was 22 years old. Just as I came out, just as I finished my teacher ed program, we had here in California the Briggs Initiative that would have made it.
You should explain that a little bit, because we have a
Proposition 6 in 1978 would have made it so they could fire any teacher who was gay or even perceived to be gay. It was a terrible thing. A lot of people don't remember a fact about this later now, that one of the people who was instrumental in defeating this was actually Ronald Reagan, because he said that he had lived through the Hollywood blacklist era, seen how it had ruined people's lives, and he perceived that this could have done the same thing. But it was very, very dicey for people to come, teachers to come out and go door to door and distribute this literature and fight this. And I read something about it recently that reminded me that 20-some years ago, it disproportionately affected women too, because that was 20-some years ago, that was one of the main careers for women. And so people that fought that had to be tremendously courageous to make themselves visible and fight it. And I was just starting, you know, and I didn't know, will I ever even become a teacher? I wouldn't have if that had passed. And I just, you know, it did. I found it extremely empowering. And I think that there are still some, I have colleagues and friends who are gay and lesbian and who teach. And I think for many people, unfortunately, even though that was defeated, there's still some fear that have made them reluctant to step forward and be a role model. But I always figure that we know what it was like to have experienced this harassment in junior high and high school, and sometimes even younger. And I feel like if we don't stand up for the kids in this generation, who will? So I try to, any students that come out to me and confide in me, I try to pass on this sense of empowerment to them and how it, you can't let someone else do it for you, you know? You've got to get involved in the political process, and you've got to speak out whenever you can and do what you can to help other people.
I think there's also a lot of people that don't really know how bad it is.
No, they don't.
You know, in terms of for our students or for
Definitely.
Our teachers, because the schools are such a closed environment. Mm-hmm. I don't want to say they're like prisons, because that would be demeaning. I mean, obviously they're also places of enlightenment, mm-hmm. and where you get liberated and lots of good stuff happens. But in that sense of a closed society where the outside world, students don't tell their parents what it's like, sometimes mm-hmm. teachers don't tell their spouses or partners, you know, if it's really bad what they went through, and or sometimes they can. Administrators always pretend there's nothing mm-hmm. bad going on there. And we heard some stories. I mean, yeah. I'm sure you all have stories too. Actually, we should probably mention some of them if you remember some of the student stories that were told at yeah. Queer Youth Lobby Day that were very compelling.
Let me think of a couple. I remember one student from a high school in Los Angeles, out in the sort of West Valley area, who was threatened numerous times with rape, and had notes passed to her saying, "Hey, Dyke, you stupid bitch, I'm gonna rape you." And then the same person would come by her in the hallway again and again and say, "Remember what I said." She was so
distraught. I'm
yeah,
sure.
obviously, and so yeah. she couldn't turn to her parents. She didn't want to talk about that. She got support through her Project 10, so that was really a great resource. And fortunately, we have student support systems in some parts of the state. But that's one example. One student who said he tried out for the football team, and the coach said, "I don't want any fags on the team." That was his ninth grade year. He ended up dropping out of that school. Another student, very conflicted, really troubled, went to a very, very crowded school in sort of central city Los Angeles, was called names on such a daily so many names on a daily basis, and he wrote a whole list of them, you know, fag, puta, this, that, you know, just mm-hmm. on and on and on, that he ended up avoiding classes and had to go to continuing school mm-hmm. Because he couldn't finish on time. The harassment was too intense. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I gathered, I went out and spoke to hundreds of students during the course of the campaign to pass this bill, and virtually every single one of them had some kind of story to tell. Mm-hmm. They wrote letters on this campaign, and some of them were heartbreaking. But some of them were great, because they were like, "People stare at us when we slow dance," you know what I mean? So there was this other kind of, you know, and I was like, great, but we need both stories. We need to have the people who are pushing the envelope, you know, for like full equality, and also we need to think about the really terrible impact for those students who are most in distress. So there's a range of, I mean, every gay and lesbian student, lots and lots of straight students who are perceived to be gay or lesbian. Mm-hmm.
You know, there was a lot of great support from the parents, too. And I remember, Valerie, you remember the Mother's mm-hmm. Day
Yes,
story?
I'd like to share that with you if I might. One thing I also wanted to add is something that I tell a lot of people as far as, you know, the relationship with the parents. There are many students whose parents are wonderfully supportive, like the story of this lady I'm going to tell you in a moment. But what a lot of people don't realize, and teachers, when they kind of get this when I tell them, students who belong to just about any other minority group, whether it be an ethnic or religious minority, when they're harassed at school, they can turn to the home for their support and understanding. Many students who are gay and lesbian cannot turn to their parents for that, particularly if the parents have a homophobic and negative attitude towards that. So they really need the support of other adults who are in the school and other students, because sometimes they don't get that at home. Now, some people are like my friend Felisa, who her son tried to start a GSA at his high school and didn't meet with success in that. And she became involved, and her involvement took the form of she wrote a letter to every woman in the California Assembly on Mother's Day of 1999. Mm-hmm. And you probably remember this.
I do.
And she so moved some of the people that were part of the assembly by doing this that some other people who would have been, some women who would have been unlikely allies, I think, in the assembly, helped to get the ball rolling with this, helped to get it passed, in large part as a result of Felisa's outreach. And to just tell her story of, you know, I'm a mother and this is my son and this is what he's gone through. And her son has become a magnificent example of empowerment and mm-hmm. activism and doing work for others.
Well, the continuing education piece strikes me about schools, because every new generation of students, every new year, it's like they've come in, they don't know it's the law, they don't know what their rights are. It's doesn't it seem like sort of an endless education?
It is. You start from scratch in September.
I mean, I think you've got a job forever here, Diane.
Yeah. Well, I think over time, school climates will begin to change. I don't think it necessarily has to be starting from the beginning with every year. I think we'll see a lot of changes, and I think we have already with this law, and it's only been in effect for a short period of time. So I think over the next few years, we're going to see a lot of changes in school climates and among students, and it'll get to the point, I think, where you won't have to teach people again every year about their rights, and it'll just already be in place.
I did something this year for our new teachers, because they hadn't been there last year when I gave my presentation, so I made handouts and things for them to bring them up to speed, because there's a lot of people that still don't know about it, and it is a continuous process of educating. But also, being a teacher, you know, I know that sometimes people don't catch on to things the first time. When they keep hearing that reentry and they keep hearing that reiterated and approached in different ways, I think the more that goes on, the more people will come to accept this. We've been fighting, you know, racism in our schools for the last 35 or 40 years and sexism for the last 30 years. There's still a lot to be done, but we've made some major inroads.
Yeah. I'm glad that you mentioned, I'm sorry to cut you
yeah.
off, but I'm glad you mentioned both of those things, because I think they're perfect examples of how laws grow into cultures.
Mm-hmm, they
and
do.
How, and how something like Title IX, no one ever really thought of girls and sports as mm-hmm. being something that deserve, you know, equal treatment with boys in sports. And now it's something of an expectation
yes,
that
it's
girls
a given.
Can exactly. So
yeah.
we have these you know, schools have programs for girls. You know, it's just a different culture, and we've made the progress because of the law mm-hmm. and because people had to comply with it, and we created systems mm-hmm. of compliance, and we created systems of education. Now parents are so proud of their girl athletes, and
yes,
they're so
they
proud
are.
Of their involvement. And I think that's a great success story that we can look to as the future of AB 537.
Well, it must be a really dangerous thing to have this kind of equality, because now we notice the Supreme Court is paying a lot of attention to unraveling that
mm-hmm.
law, and their recent decision that said, and it was particularly about schools and civil rights, that you could no longer assume discrimination from a factual basis. You had to
prove
show
intent, right?
that there
yeah.
was intent. And I'm certain that Title IX is the next law that will
yep.
be challenged.
It's analogous to Title VI. It's going to face the same exact challenge. The Federalist Society has got it on its radar screen. And I mean, they say things like Title IX is just a tool for feminists to marginalize boys. I mean, crazy stuff. So mm-hmm. When what it demands is opportunities for girls. It's just, it's frightening. I'm not sure how we have to come together to defend those civil rights laws, to defend that progress and those cultures that we've created of equality and the expectation of equality. But we've got to do it.
Well, the question is sort of who takes the lead in other states. I mean, a lot of people, of course, in other states think, oh, well, California is such a liberal state, which I'm sure you'll find amusing, Valerie, mm-hmm. teaching in Orange County.
Not all of California.
Well, and I would say way more than half of California is fairly conservative. I mean, our Central Valley, the whole northern end, parts of San Diego, Orange County. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's only really the two main urban centers and some of the slightly smaller urban centers.
Santa Cruz is very enlightened.
And Santa Cruz. Well, some of the university towns have gotten to be, as in many other states. And people will say, gee, I don't know, I'm going to, you know, bust my nose against that brick wall, and maybe it works in California, but I don't know that it'll work here. And I think it's really important for people to know how hard it was here. Mm-hmm. Because it just takes that kind of endless, I'm back, you know, we failed mm-hmm. this time, but I'm back with another try at the law or another petition or another request or another demand or whatever. And I think there might be a way we can even mentor to other states. I don't know if the ACLU takes leadership on this issue or just because, you know, you guys are there.
There are some tools available at the ACLU's national website that promote safe schools. I haven't seen a particular kit, and I think this is something that the folks who helped pass AB 537 will put together, but like an action plan, a model for other states. That's a piece that we really need to kick out into the world, because you're right, it wasn't because California's so liberal that this got passed, it was because communities were committed to getting it passed. Mm-hmm. And I think that model of involving youth, involving teachers and parents, really has to be sort of put out there. The bill's available so people can see what it looks like. Mm-hmm. And
well, you know, it's interesting when we talk about other people fighting for our rights, one of the things that has happened around AB 537 is a focus on the issue of transgender mm-hmm. students or transsexual students. And people say, well, you know, I never even heard of such a thing. And in a way, we are called upon, who are not transgender or transsexual specifically, to stand up as well for the issues and the interests, because many transsexual students or people are not gay. They are, there's another issue of gender involved. And when I brought a bill several years ago to amend the hate crimes statute, one of the things we did was to add in the definition of gender that it would be a hate crime if you committed the crime against a person because you didn't think they were looking or acting mm-hmm. appropriately for their gender, their traditional way their gender should act. And that was incorporated, and then when we did 537, we simply referenced that act. So we scooped in not only sexual orientation, but by reference, this other issue, and of course this task force had to deal with how you now issue guidelines. Mm-hmm. Have you gotten any inquiries about how to make that real in the schools?
I have.
Oh, really?
Oh,
yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I mean, I was asking Diana if I don't recall any specific transgender requests coming in yet, but that's going to be a complex one, definitely. Mm-hmm. You have?
I was privileged to, when I attended a California Teachers Association conference recently, get to hear Dana Rivers speak. I don't know if you're familiar with mm-hmm. Dana Rivers, but she's a male-to-female transsexual who did a wonderful job up in Northern California, I believe it's Antelope School District, but there was a great controversy over that. But she's now become a really wonderful spokesperson for transgender issues. She pointed out that it's not so difficult to accommodate the things that people freak out saying, oh, what about PE class? What about bathrooms? Things like that.
Sounds like the ERA all over again.
Yeah, and she pointed out that almost every school has a private restroom that's in the nurse's office or something that a student could use, that it doesn't need to be such a big deal. She pointed out that when new schools schools are constructed, they could be done more like campgrounds where you have single restrooms that doesn't matter which gender uses them. It's kind of become an excuse for people to say that, oh, this is unmanageable. But something that when you mentioned transgender issues, that I think is so important, and I think that we in the gay and lesbian community do have to help to carry the ball for our friends and that are transgender or transsexual, because what it really comes down to in a big way is that all of us are in some way gender nonconformist. And there are many, many straight people who are the same way. There are many, you know, this is a sexism issue. This doesn't mm-hmm. just involve gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgendered people. It involves everyone. It involves the roles that women at one time were forced to conform to. It involves the constraints that are put upon men about whether or not they can share their feelings. And it's a whole, it really, at the bottom line, is a sexism issue.
Go ahead, Chris.
I just really agree with you about that. And I think that one of the pieces that's really important here, too, is if you look at the younger age group of students, the elementary school students, and even kindergarten students, what they're focusing on when peers are targeted, it's gender nonconformity. It's gender nonconformity. And so that's really a critical piece that it was just really good luck to have that folded into the mm-hmm. bill through the process of it passing through the legislature, because I think that's the core experience for people who are gay or lesbian as well. It's mm-hmm. as
it
you
is.
Say.
Well, and people say, why are you guys making such a big deal about gender? I mean, I've been doing on what other people used to call women's issues. I've been working on those for many years. And people say, why do you make such a big deal out of this gender thing and about, you know, out of what sex people are? And I said, well, what's the only question that anybody ever asks when a baby's
mm-hmm.
born?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, they say, they don't even ask you about the gender. They say, what'd you have?
Mm-hmm.
And everybody knows that's only one question involved in what'd you have. Did you have a boy or a girl? Why is that the question? If you were a Martian anthropologist and you were saying, I'm looking at this species and what they really value, what must be the critical issues for them, I would have to look at what question was asked at the first moment of a human being's life.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody says, oh, well, you know, that's just culture. Yeah. Well, culture embeds a lot of what we don't even think about in terms of our issues.
And the question,
what you have.
Yeah. Well, the question that that transgender people experience is, what are you?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's the horrible yeah. kind of like attack. This, what are you?
I had that as a young teacher.
Yeah.
I'd be walking down the hall and I'd hear that from behind me.
Mm-hmm.
And before I was tenured, I was afraid to, you know, to turn around and confront the person who would say that. But I would get that myself. Even being a teacher, even being a person in charge and hearing this from kids mm-hmm. and being afraid mm-hmm. to confront it.
And in middle school and high school, where people are really going through their, I mean, the puberty is sort of all about this differentiation in a way. At least that's what it's made to be about. Because how can you know how you're going to involve yourself in, you know, mating rituals unless you know sort of what you are?
Mm-hmm.
And so it becomes even more crazy and difficult. But I've always been interested, though, in why the right wing is not only interested in our issues, but absolutely focused on the schools as the place mm-hmm. to also worry a great deal and do their work. You know, why education? Why this main issue about, why not the workplace where they could find everybody too? Why is it about students?
Well, I think that people that have a fairly literalistic or authoritarian set of values have a great deal invested in wanting to see that those values are carried on and passed on to other generations. We see this with things like the recent issue in Anaheim, California, with the books about lives of notable gay and lesbians, that they removed them from the shelves, and ACLU was very instrumental in redressing that. There's this terror that, oh, they're somehow even going to find out that there's such a thing as gay and lesbian people. Well, that's kind of ridiculous in today's world with Will and Grace on TV and everything like that. But there's this, it seems like they want to censor out even the idea that we exist and enforce this invisibility. And I think that not only in gay and lesbian issues, but in issues of things like many of these same groups want to restore prayer to the schools. They want to completely resist any kind of realistic or non-judgmental sex mm-hmm. education. They have this abstinence thing where basically they won't even give kids what could be life-saving information about STD and AIDS prevention because, oh, we don't dare mention this, even though parents can withdraw their kids from the classes if they want to. And so I think it's this silence around it. And there's a very good organization, I believe it's called CECAS, that puts information out, and there's about how in Europe, students are given realistic information about things that affects their lives. Where here, it's kind of like there's a culture in the schools nowadays where you treat the students like children, protect them from any controversy, deny them any input, and then suddenly expect them to be instant adults when they graduate. And they're not getting, at least in the schools in Orange County, I see that happening a lot. There's this attitude that we have to protect students, you know, from anything that could be a possible controversy.
You know what, I think actually there's an interesting connection to the racial privacy initiative that's coming up, because what the right wing wants to do is actually bury any kind of controversy. They want to bury even any reference to race. They want to make all of this invisible, and they want to basically try to edit out any kind of difference or any source of disagreement. And it's something that I think is a basic fundamental part of their strategy. They want to pretend that there's a sameness, that there's an innocence, that there's that we aren't involved in a world that that includes difference. Mm-hmm. So,
and I think that really negatively affects students as well, because I think a lot of the students that I've encountered just feel like invisible. They feel like they don't have any control and they don't have any say, and that really negatively affects them. And I think that's one of the most important things about this bill and about our project, is really trying to make students visible and tell them that these issues exist and that they do have a voice and they can, they do have the power to change things. And so I think it's really important to not stand for that silence.
There's a big difference between high schools and colleges though, isn't there? Just in terms of what students can do. I mean, I think students are very held down in high school. Mm-hmm. And also very passive. I could be wrong, because obviously we're talking about activism. Right. But generally, I spoke at a high school on a panel the other day just about political involvement, because you know, most of the students was all senior class and government class, and they were all 17, some of them were 18, and they're going to vote, or they do vote. And they seem very passive to me.
I haven't really encountered that much. I think people just, they don't, I think sometimes they may feel hopeless, and sometimes they feel like it's pointless to try to make a difference, but I think once students are aware that there is a bill and that there is something that they can do, they're very eager to try to make a difference.
So what's the next step? What should we do next?
Well, I'm very, very happy that the California Department of Education, Delaney Easton office, has now sent this letter to school districts. I feel that makes a huge difference in having this from the top guidance. And I think that the recommendations that were come up with by the task force, hopefully those will start to be implemented. I think you asked me before about GLSEN. GLSEN is the Gay, Lesbian, Straight Education Network. We're a nationwide organization, and we're the premier organization nationwide working to end anti-gay prejudice in K-12 schools. Each chapter has local activism. What we're involved in doing right now, we want to contact the superintendents of schools, now that they've received this material from the California Department of Education, to offer our services, you know, in a very cost-effective way, in a way that's tailored to the individual district, that's simple and easy to understand. Because from our standpoint, what we feel like is extremely important is to reach the teachers and administrators. And we want to work along with groups like the GSA Network here in California and ACLU Make It Real Project that are empowering the students, because having both focuses to bring students in and empower them, to reach the teachers, because something like 75% of the educators in this country have had absolutely no training about gay and lesbian issues. And some of those surveys that were done not only showed that kids heard an anti-gay slur like "that's so gay" or "fag" 26 times a day in school, over a third of them had heard them from staff members, which is really shocking. And I know ACLU right now is working with a case up in Visalia, California, where a student was harassed by a teacher. Hmm. So I feel like it's really essential that all teachers, whether they're in their pre-service training or they're already in the classroom, receive this training. I think that's probably the most important thing that at least GLSEN, the chapter that I'm affiliated, is working with. And what I've tried to do in my own district in bringing it out, bringing this information to the schools. But I think that the focus from both angles, from the students and from directed to teachers and administrators, and also with groups like the PTA and with PFLAG, so that the parents are brought into it, so that they understand the purpose of this, they don't feel so threatened by it. They see very clearly that it is not about, quote, recruiting people to a lifestyle. It's about supporting kids who need to have this support, because that's a big myth and a big reason that it's taken so long to have action on this. Many teachers have been afraid to be, you know, accused of, quote, recruiting students and things like that. So I think, you know, probably all three of these angles. And definitely including PFLAG and the parents' groups as well.
Well, it's a good summary. We're almost out of time. I mean, it's amazing to me how fast the time goes on this show. I want to thank all three of you for being here and talking about this stuff. I want to thank you for being here, too. There's a lot that you can do in your local schools, in your local school districts, wherever you live, wherever you are, because we need to eradicate not only gay bashing, but all forms of discrimination and harassment in our schools. And I say to America, get used to it.